Next, what we're going to do is we're going to look at how to compute separately with the matrices and the right-hand side in the appended system. The reason for this is that often one has the matrix and can start computing with that matrix, but one right-hand side or more right-hand sides come along later on. And what we're going to see is that this actually has the potential to save you from having to recompute with many of the entries in the appended system. So how does this work? Here is our appended system. What we're going to do is we're going to forget about the fact that there is a right-hand side there. So we're just strictly going to work with the matrix. And recall that that matrix really came from doing a matrix vector multiply to come up with the left-hand side of the system of linear equations. Left-hand side being the parts of the equations that are to the left of the equal signs. And then later on, we can go and apply all of the computation that we performed to the right-hand side after the fact. So we're now talking about how to take a matrix and reduce it to an upper triangular matrix via Gauss transforms. Here we have our appended system. And if we had the appended system, then we would compute a Gauss transform and apply that Gauss transform to eliminate some of the coefficients. And then we would compute another Gauss transform, which would then leave us with an upper triangular system of equations, or an upper triangular appended system, or whatever you want to call it. Now, we could simply forget about the right-hand side, because remember, when you do a matrix-matrix multiply, you can think of that as multiplying times the columns separately, and therefore, what happens is not going to be impacted at all by how the Gauss transform is applied to the right-hand side. So what we can do then is compute our entries in our Gauss transform, apply the Gauss transform to only the part of the appended system to the left of the vertical line, in other words, to the matrix. And then we can do that again. We can compute the entries in the Gauss transform, apply it, and we're left with an upper triangular matrix. Now here we didn't actually write the zeros, but you can imagine where the zeros are. Then, if we stored the Gauss transforms, then we could a posteriori, after the fact, come back and apply those to the right-hand sides, to the right-hand side, to have the same net effect as if we had done so when we were working with the matrix earlier and when we were actually computing those Gauss transforms. And then we can go on and do our back substitution and solve the upper triangular system. As always, check your answer. So what we have now is a systematic way for transforming the matrix to an upper triangular matrix. If we then store the Gauss transforms, we can apply those to the right-hand side after the fact. This is known as forward substitution, which I misspelled here. And notice that if then later on, with the same matrix, a new right-hand side comes along, you don't have to actually go and perform Gaussian elimination, this reduction to an upper triangular matrix, with that matrix. All you need to do is store the Gauss transforms so that you can do forward substitution with the new right-hand side.